Life Audio.
Welcome to Empowering Homeschool Conversations, your authority in navigating the world of homeschooling diverse learners. Featuring Peggy Ployer from Sped Homeschool, Annie Yorty from AnnieYorty.com, Leilani Melendez from Living with Eve, Stephanie Buckwalter from ELARP Learning, and Dawn Jackson from Dawn Jackson Educational Consulting and Tutoring. With over 75 years of combined homeschooling expertise, experiences, and perspectives, this group is eager to share their wealth of wisdom to empower your homeschooling journey. So grab your favorite mug, settle in, and get ready for insightful discussions, valuable insights, and practical tips as these experts and their guests dive into the hottest topics in homeschooling. Whether you're a seasoned homeschooler, just considering this path, or anywhere in between, you don't want to miss a minute of these enlightening conversations that will empower your child to thrive in their homeschool environment. Empowering Homeschool Conversations is starting right now. Join us to give your homeschool the power boost it needs to successfully educate the unique learners in your home.
Today, we're going to talk about From Trauma to Triumph, Homeschooling a Diverse Family. And my guest today is Sherry McMinn. She is a Christian nonfiction author and speaker, and she's a mom to 11 by marriage, birth, and adoption, and homeschooled 9 through their high school graduation. She's also the treasurer of Sped Homeschool and our board of directors, and she has an exciting announcement. Her fifth book, Embracing Diversity as a Family, Preparing for the Next Generation to Flourish, is launching any day now. We were hoping it was going to be launched by the time we had this broadcast. Not yet, but very close. But we're going to share some resources for you, and we're looking forward to that. So welcome, Sherry, to the show. I'm so excited to have you here.
Peggy, it's great to be here. I always enjoy our conversations.
Yes. Yeah. You have a wealth of information. I got to review Sherry's book, so I got a little bit of a sneak peek. And it was one of those books where you just want to like curl up on the couch because you have so many good stories that you share in there and just the experiences you've had in your life. And you kind of get immersed in this, in Sherry's ability to just kind of draw you into the lessons that God has taught her through her lifetime and so many lessons. But we're going to talk a little bit on that diversity aspect today, which is kind of the theme for your new book. And I would love for you to share with us just a little bit of background. I know you shared a little bit about your family, but just a little bit more about that, and then this topic of diversity and how that kind of happened in your family. That's probably a good way to start.
That sounds great. Well, I grew up in a loving Christian family. My parents were just awesome. My dad recently passed away. My mom's still alive. She's 91. And grew up in the 1960s during the civil rights era, and along with all the other stuff that happened, the Vietnam War and sexual revolution and all that. And my parents were just wonderful about sitting around the dinner table and talking about current events and what was going on in culture and how our Christian faith caused us to maybe be different. And one of the neat things about my dad, he was a very significant attorney with a lot of influence. And at that time in Wichita, Kansas, he was the only white attorney that took on clients who were Black, Hispanic, Jewish, you know, the non-white middle class. And that was a really significant thing. And another thing is my dad never wanted to join the country club, even though he loved golf, because they only admitted, you know, a certain narrow profile of people. So that was my first exposure to people who were different than me. And my parents were involved in urban ministries and other things. And then as I grew up in my schooling, I went to public school and we had desegregation. And so I had friends who did not look like me, and I love that. Although there were other people who looked like me that did not want such a diverse circle of friends. And so then when I went to college, I went to the University of Colorado in Boulder. And that was a very, very diverse campus, and not just skin tone, but economic class, people from foreign countries. You know, it was just a whole new wonderful world. And I loved it. I've always loved different art, culture, food, everything that was just typical of the family I came from. And so my husband and I got married and we started having kids. My oldest son is my stepson from his my husband's first marriage. So that added some diversity.
Right.
And we started having kids. And the when we had children, we had diversity in the neuro aspect.
And yes, which is a lot of our community.
I just didn't really understand. And so I started investigating. You know, I had highly gifted kids, but they also struggled with simple things like reading. So I started researching. And then I discovered that, you know, my husband has some issues. And, you know, I mean, beyond the regular marital issues.
Right.
And so I've always been an avid researcher and reader. And so I read books. And then when the internet came online, just so many online articles about diversity is so much more than skin tone. It's, you know, there are 8 billion people on the planet, and every single one of us has a different brain, different fingerprints, a different eye image for retinal scanning. I mean, we are, it's made us unique. And he wanted to do that. He wanted us to be diverse. We are to embrace that. And I feel like we're to love the person right in front of us, no matter how different they are from us. So then at one point, my husband and I decided we wanted to have more kids, and we could not have more birth children. And so we decided that we would pursue adoption. So over the years, we adopted 2 different sets of siblings, so a total of 5 children. And they brought a real diversity to our family. The first 2 that we adopted were Black and Hispanic. And then the next trio of siblings, who were 1, 2, and 3 when they came to us. And yes, it was total The oldest daughter of the 3 was part Native American. And there are certain tribal
Two adopted siblings with tribe that are Native American.
Yes, but because her father, a birth father that was Native American, did not have a tribal affiliation, then we were free to adopt her with the other 2 who were her half siblings. So we just had all kinds of different things about in our family. And then, of course, there were cognitive delays because a couple of the kids were really abused and neglected at, when they were young. Their executive functioning didn't develop. So on and on, I kept learning more and more about how each one of the members of my family was uniquely created by God for his purposes. And because we were homeschooling, we could teach each child at their ability level with the things they were interested in. And if we could get them to learn to read and write and do arithmetic, then they had a whole world to learn about in science, history, civics, everything else. And because at that point in time, we lived on a farm, the kids could be outside a lot, which I just laugh because, you know, now people promote 1,000 hours outside and all these things. And I think, well, that's how my kids grew up. And, you know, with nature all around them, and they could build tree houses, and they could ride horses and take care of animals. And all of these kind of hands-on experiential learning opportunities were just so great, no matter what my child's gift or, you know, their delays were. It was a thriving life, and the children learned to acclimate and they began to flourish. And so 2 years ago, I graduated my youngest. She's now 20. And so I'm a grandma now, which is awesome.
Yay.
But all of my kids really are flourishing. A couple of them still struggle with trauma from their past, and they always will. I mean, it just is a burden they'll always carry on their back.
Right.
But they at least are able to establish relationships and to work. And some of them who I was the most concerned about are the ones who are absolutely soaring. And it's because
that's so encouraging.
You know, we really trusted the Lord to show us what we should do. And we treated each child as an individual and just helped them be able to figure out who they are, what their strengths were, overcome their weaknesses. And I just feel like God sent me on this incredible journey. And I just love it. And of course, it took a toll on my health and everything else, but it was all worth
always
it.
Always does.
Yeah, it was all worth it. And I would do it again.
We will continue this conversation after a short break.
This is Empowering Homeschool Conversations, provided by Sped Homeschool, a nonprofit that empowers families to home educate diverse learners. To learn more, visit spedhomeschool.com.
I think when you are a parent raising neurotypical children who just fit in the box of the A, B, or C student, you know,
right.
there's still issues. There's parent-child issues, there's marital issues, there's outside influences.
Right.
But when you, I think God chooses us to be the parents of extra special kids, and He gives us extra grace, and He shows us what to do if we look to Him.
Yeah. Oh, so true. Yes. It is true. And it is truly a day by day walk of faith. And you did that 11 times over. And so, yeah, treating each kid differently, that is so difficult, because I think we want to just, like, you know, box them up and say, okay, this is the category you fit in. So this is how I deal with you. And I can just do steps 1, 2, and 3, and then we're good. But that's not how God works with us or our kids. It's on an individual basis. And taking the time to really understand and know that child and understand their heart, where they struggle, what they love, you know, that I think we talk about that over and over again on this show, but I with this topic of diversity, it's good to remember that no one is the same. There's no average. And that we're not striving for that. We're striving for who God made each person to be.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And even if you have twins that are identical, my older sisters are identical twins. And yes, they, you know, dressed alike and talked alike and did all those things. But as adults, they're completely different people. And each one of us is the image of God. He created us in His image. We're His image bearers. Yet as vast as He is, which is the universe, you know, He has no beginning, no ending. Then every single one of us is different. And that is on purpose. And, you know, children can learn to read at the age of 2 or maybe not till 10th grade. And
right. Exactly.
My one son, who probably is the most, has the highest IQ of all my children, didn't really feel comfortable reading till about 8th grade. So, yet he took up on every single appliance and learned that way. So.
Oh, that's great. Yes. Well, and you know, speaking of diversity and God loving diversity, it's not a wonder why the world is so opposed to diversity, you know, and that there's so much just hostility about people being different or, it seems like when you bring up this topic that people just start to get angry. It's really, you know, a scheme of the enemy against God's plan that people would be different. They would learn differently. They would look differently. They would act differently because really we as a body reflect him. And right. So, you know, what is like hot topics right now where we're seeing this coming up in society that parents can start talking to their kids, even if they don't have diversity within their home, that it can be a way to start teaching and equipping with truth.
Yes, exactly. And I think one of the most important things that we need to teach our children is that their identity and their confidence is in God. He created them the way he wanted to at conception. He had in mind even before conception what they would be. And it's not a bad thing if you are maybe not exceptional in one area or capable in one area, but every person has great strengths. You know, they've identified, you know, the EQ, emotional quotient, and other people have talked about all the different smarts that you have. And we need all of those together to have a successful life and a flourishing world. And if we think about what it's going to be like in heaven with every single tongue, language, tribe, and all of us worshiping the Lamb who sits on the throne, we need all of that. And I think the more we can appreciate that people, each individual is different. And again, just love the person right in front of us. That's important. Mm-hmm. But people who deny God want to have a pecking order. You know, they want to put themselves above someone else, which means they have to put someone down. And that's because they lack confidence in who they are as God's creation. So if we can learn to teach our children that they were uniquely and wonderfully created and made, just how God intended them, whether they're highly gifted, whether they have Down syndrome, whether they are physically handicapped, whether they are just a neurotypical kid, that's where their confidence should lie, is in the fact that they're God's creation. And then he will show us as parents what we should do for our kids and to help them. And the really neat thing is, you know, when I was a kid, it was a big deal to just go to your grandparents' house in a different state.
Oh, yeah.
And then as I grew up, it's like, wow, people were shocked I was going to go out of state to college. And I was blessed to be able to go to Europe when I was a college student. Well, my kids go all over everywhere now. And I have a daughter who's an entrepreneur. And she has clients in Egypt and the Ukraine. And we just live in a totally global world. And God is bringing all kinds of immigrants to our country who are totally different than us. And they're right in our communities. And, you know, I love going to Walmart because it's like the most diverse place in my community. And I'm going to be friendly to people. And people are surprisingly shocked that you're friendly to them. And then they'll start talking, you know,
right?
Because we were built for relationship. And whether it's relationship with our spouse or our kids or our neighbors or someone that we just randomly meet in the airport, people want to talk and learn about each other. And if we can teach our kids to be conversationalists, and a lot of our kids have trouble expressing themselves verbally or talking to people. And of course, we don't want them to just go up to random strangers when they're little kids and talk to them. But if they can learn to have conversation with us, and then conversation with people in safe spaces at our homeschool group or our church or wherever, then that's really giving them a foundation for being able to share their faith, share their life, and just love people no matter where they go, what they do. And I'm currently at my son's house around my little 3-year-old grandson, and one of my granddaughters, who's also 3, has been visiting here. And they both just are such good talkers, and it's because parents have talked with them all the time. Right. And the questions they ask are hilarious, or what they say. But this is how we should be spending time as adults with children, is engaging them in conversation, reading stories to them, doing life with them, working in the garden, holding hands, walking through the zoo, because that is how kids learn. Kids should not be learning. I mean, of course, we can use the internet and screens and all that to help our kids, but they need to be actively learning with us.
We will continue this conversation after a short break.
This is Empowering Homeschool Conversations, provided by Sped Homeschool, a nonprofit that empowers families to home educate diverse learners. To learn more, visit spedhomeschool.com.
Those interactions that are so important. I know my husband and I were walking the dog last night, and as we walked past the park, there was a guy pushing his child in the swing, and he was looking at his phone. And my husband said, "How sad." He wasn't even interacting with his child, and his child was right there. I know a lot of people get frustrated with me when they're like, "Well, I texted you and messaged you and you never responded back." And I'm like, "My phone's in another room." I check it when I have time. And, you know, just have those healthy boundaries in our lives, that family. And I wish I would have learned that sooner. You know, it wasn't something that my parents did. My parents did a lot of things that didn't involve us as kids, that set a bad example as far as like even ministry. You know, you do something good, but yet when you neglect your family within the house, it makes it hard.
It is. One of the things that I treasure about my family is, you know, that my good husband died 11 years ago. It was a real shocker. He died of a heart attack in his sleep. I still had 5 kids home to homeschool. But he purposely decided when we started having kids that he was not going to be the workaholic greatest architect on the planet. That he was, his importance in life was to be a dad. And so he was an all-in homeschooling dad. And sometimes it would drive me crazy because he'd come in the house and say, "I was going to take the kids to the hardware store. Are you guys busy doing anything?" I'm like, "Yeah, we're trying to do math." "Oh, well,
we can do math at the hardware store."
And I am so glad he did that, because then when he passed away, all my kids lost their best friend. But they had known him. And so now they continue on with their lives on the things that he had talked to them about doing. And I can't encourage dads enough to really be involved in the homeschooling of their children. It's not just the stay-at-home mom's job. It's the dad's job as well. And I'm really excited because at the Rocky Mountain Homeschool Conference next week, we have what's called the Fatherhood Boot Camp. Because parents just don't know what to do with their kids. And I just so appreciate hardworking dads that go to work, support their families, you know, try to do the things that they should do. And it's really a toxic world out there for, if you want to be a masculine man who's a Christian leader in your home, you know, the world is telling you the opposite. But men are so important in the dynamic. And of course, there's a lot of single moms that are homeschooling, and I totally get that. But if they can find some kind of male role model, whether it's a family friend, a grandpa, an uncle, you know, pastor at the church, whatever, kids need a balance. And we see that lack of fatherhood in our country, what it's done right now. And I'm just so impressed to see my one son right now, who's a dad, how he just loves being with his kids. He comes from work, and he's just actively doing stuff with his son. And it just does my heart so good. And my other kids who aren't married, the other sons are talking about, well, one day if I get married and have kids, and I'm like, yes, I'm praying. Just know they've had this wonderful example from their dad, but also my dad, their grandfather, was just a wonderful guy. In fact, my dad and I, there were four girls in my family and then a brother born much, much later. So I was a tomboy that my dad took fishing and
Yes.
And it was great because then I had three boys and then I had a farm. And so I knew how to do all this stuff. And I just treasure all that time I got to spend with my dad. Now he passed away in April. But I told him, you know, we're going to go marlin fishing in heaven, Dad. I'm sure there's an ocean up there. So,
anyway. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. So your life has taken so many ups and downs, and, you know, and you shared some of those. And I know there's other tragedies that have happened and, you know, other just, you know, wonderful moments too. And your book goes into that and your previous books cover some of that too. But what life lessons have you learned that might be applicable to our audience that you might want to share?
Well, probably the most important life lesson that I've learned is, you know, life can change in a second. Yeah. And it's really important that you live each day for what it is. I think we live in the greatest country in the world, and we have great freedom to homeschool our children. We have great freedom to have a family that is whatever it is, whether it's one child, whether it's 10 children, whether it's neurotypical kids, whether it's delayed readers or whatever. And God has given you the family he wants you to have. And he, you know, we are accountable to him when we go to heaven. Mm-hmm. We will stand before him and we want to hear him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Part of my trauma story, you know, is I have my own PTSD because I had a baby that died suddenly as an infant. And then I had a teenage daughter who was tragically murdered. And so I am so grateful that I was able to be with both of those daughters all the days that I was and to give them the life that they had, because tomorrows are not promised. And it could be a car wreck. It could be sickness, whatever. And you know that last October I was in Houston and I had a major.
We were supposed to get together.
Yeah, I had this major medical horrible thing where I went to the emergency room with heart, kidney, and lung problems all at the same time. And I thought, wow, is today the day I'm going? I mean, I don't want it to be. I mean, I can't wait to be with the Lord, but I have many more years I hope to spend with my family and my grandchildren. And so we do have to not get caught up in the rat race so much that we forget the person in front of us needs us. And whether it's the 2-year-old who cut their finger or the 12-year-old who can't figure out why her body's changing, or the 17-year-old son who wants to be a man, but he still acts like a kid and you don't know what to do with them.
Yep.
Which I know what has gone through.
Yes.
We need to stop and to look at that person and to meet their need. And yes, that means that we probably put our life on hold. I mean, I feel like I put my life on hold for a long time because I had this great responsibility of raising all these kids that I just loved, but some of them were way more work than the others. And the ones who weren't so much work felt neglected. And so now as adults, I'm trying to reconnect and spend as much time with them as I can. So I just think we need to realize that every day is precious and every person is precious. A long time ago, I had a friend before I was married, before I had kids. And he said, you know, let's just go to the zoo and walk around. So we walked around the Denver Zoo. He was a good friend of mine. I knew from work. You know, there was no romantic relationship or anything. We were just friends. And so the last thing I said to him is, okay, let's get together again soon. You know, well, we never did. And then 5 years later, he died. And I thought, wow, I should have made more of an effort to get together with him. So I think it's real important that you and I enjoy our life as much as possible. The family we have, the responsibilities that God has given us. I mean, right now, my job is to mentor other parents, and I just love doing that. People will email me with these heartfelt questions. I'm like, okay, what's said on email stays on email. I would ask these five things and, you know, call me back. It's okay. You can just vent. I'm a safe person. And so God has given me a season of life where I can do that. And I want to do that. I want to say, I don't know everything, but I have gone through a lot, and I'm happy to counsel you, you know, if you need it, you just email me. So,
And so many people just need to be heard. I think we don't realize just that we don't have to have the answer. We just have to be willing to listen. And if you're willing to listen, a lot of times they'll figure it out, or God will tell them what they need to do when the time is right. But having somebody who's compassionate and caring and sitting there is like, wow, you know, you're willing to like absorb some of my stuff. Because we always think we got to carry it all by ourselves. And God, like you told us, you said earlier, God created us for community, and we need that community. We need other people around us, because the burden is too heavy for us to carry on our own. We were never meant to do that. And yes, Jesus takes our, you know, the yoke with us, but he also surrounded us with other people who are going, are you going to give me something? You know, and if we choose to just shell up and say, oh no, this is too tough to share with anybody, we're not going to be blessed by those relationships that God has intended to bless us. And exactly. So important. Exactly. So very important.
One of my adult sons lives with me, and he's busy working a lot. And then we'll sit down for dinner and ask each other about our day. And the thing is, you know, men are fixers. And I'll be saying, I have this situation, and he's trying to solve the problem. And I'm like, no, I just need to talk about it. And then I'll figure out the solution for it. So.
Oh, that's so true. Yes. And sometimes you just have to talk it out. And I've got some friends who are verbal processors. And so I know I'm kind of the tend to want to fix things. And so I learned a long time ago, just don't say anything. They don't want your answers. They just want you to know that you're listening.
And think about, you know, I'm going through medical stuff right now, and every phone call I make to the doctor or to wherever, it's like, you know, press two to speak to blah blah blah.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Press three if this is. I'm like, I just want a real person.
That is true. So true. In today's day and age, we don't realize just how much we have been isolated due to technology too, and we've allowed that to happen as well, instead of like combating it and say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to put up with this. I'm just going to like go into that person's office and say, I need to see you one-on-one.
Exactly.
So in the middle of all of this, how do we find joy?
That's a good question. You know, I think that an important thing for me is I was blessed as a child to have my parents help me realize that there were things that I really enjoyed in life that were my coping skills. So I liked reading, but I loved art, and they allowed me to just explore all different art mediums. I love listening to music that brought me joy, even though it was, you know, the rock and roll Elton John songs. It still brought me joy. Uh-huh. And I, as an adult, learned that I really enjoyed writing, which is so funny because I absolutely hated writing in school.
Wow.
Because I didn't have anything to write about. But then as an adult, I had things I wanted to write about. So I think that each adult, each parent needs to find something that they enjoy doing, whether it's gardening, walking, hiking. You know, you have your acrobatics you enjoy doing.
Absolutely.
Art, music, something, because those really are our coping skills. Mm-hmm. And then we need to help our kids learn coping skills. And again, it's, you know, we got to figure out when a three-year-old is raging, what the three-year-old needs. And maybe it's teddy bear, maybe it's music, maybe it's just cuddling, maybe it's just sitting and helping them breathe. But as they get older, what do they like? They like to kick balls. Do they like to swing on the swing set? Do they like to play with friends? Do they enjoy taking things apart? You know, one of the things we did with our boys, because they took everything apart, we would go to Goodwill and we would buy inexpensive, you know, toasters and different things and say, okay, have at it, take it apart,
right,
back together and see if it worked. A lot of times it's an animal, it's a kitten or dog, or when we lived on our farm, it was rabbits, horses, other thing. And we have super high depression and anxiety among teenagers right now in our country. And I'm not belittling that. I mean, it can be from serious trauma. But I also think kids have not been shown that hobby craft can be something that you take pleasure and confidence in. And I know when I was a kid, I did embroidery and knitting and all these different things. And I enjoyed that because there's a sense of accomplishment. You know, first it looks it's like taking music lessons. You know, at first when you start practicing the piano, it sounds horrible. But then day after day after day after year, you can make beautiful music. And I know that for my daughter who was adopted, had a lot of trauma, the one who ended up being killed. She was a gifted pianist. And anytime she was stressed, she would sit down at the piano and she would just play. And you could tell when she was stressed because it was like loud. And you know, eventually it would calm down and would become beautiful music, waltzes or whatever. And that was her coping skill. And that's how she found joy. And I do believe that we can have joy in Jesus, certainly by studying his word, learning more about him. But he also, you know, if you think about Jesus and his disciples, they just spent a lot of time together. And they went walking, they went in boats, you know, I hope that Jesus enjoyed those things. And I think he did because he helped God create all of that, you know. And so I think you need to find joy in little things. And then you need to find joy in things that will give you long-term fulfillment. And if you didn't find that as a child, then find that as an adult. And, you know, really, it can be simple as listening to audiobooks or just walking around your neighborhood, talking to your neighbors. Depends on what kind of person you are, what your learning style is. But what do you like to do? And I think a lot of times dads like to do things like work on their cars or watch football games. And that's great. That's their joy. And sometimes as wives, we think, why are they spending time doing that when they could be with me? And it's, that's their coping skill. And that's time. And, so hopefully they can do it with their kids too. I know my husband loved working on cars, and he would help have my kids help him. Of course, it takes twice as long when you have your kids
out. Exactly. Yes.
But it brought him joy and it brought them joy. And so I think sometimes we get so wrapped up in discipline of our children and homeschooling our children that we forget to just have fun together. And my kids always kidded me because I loved playing sports. I mean, I love baseball. I love soccer. I loved archery. I love basketball. And until I got to be about 50, I could beat them in everything.
Oh, wow.
I could hit home run, but I'd have to have a designated runner. But one time we were playing, and of course we had enough kids, we could have our own team, you know.
Right.
So we played sports after lunch because they needed the exercise and I needed the laughter. So we went outside on our farm, and this is probably when my son, who's 21, he was probably about 5, and he was pitching. And I connected and I hit like a home run clear out into the far farm field. And he could not believe it. And it's like I rose in his estimation 10 points that day.
You know?
And we were laughing so hard because then, of course, I couldn't really run. I had to just kind of, you know, lope around the bases. But that brought us all joy. So it could be board games. It could be basketball. It's whatever. What makes you laugh? And I just always loved it when we had a trampoline. And, of course, we had a rule, only one person jumping at a time. Well, that never happened. You know, everybody goes on there at the same time.
Yes.
And one time, my husband and I, we put the kids in bed, and we were just, like, completely exhausted, overwhelmed. And I'm like, let's go on the trampoline. He's like, what? And I said, yeah. Well, I couldn't jump on. All I could do was sit on it and laugh while he jumped. But, you know, the simple joys in life are the best. And I still remember that. It's been like 15 years. But we've got to find joy because if we don't fill up our tank, if we don't fill up our joy ATM, we have nothing to dispense to anybody else. And it's that oxygen mask thing on the airplane. You know, you put yours on first and then you help the person next to you. And we sometimes can be such martyrs when we're raising our kids. I sure was like that.
Yeah.
And so I just need to go do something. And so I'm like, kids, put a movie on. I've got to go outside. And then I came back in, and then I was a cheerful mom again. Because the last thing we want to be known for was that we were the mom that yelled and was cranky all the time. I just don't want to be remembered like that. I want to be remembered as the mom who laughed and had fun with. And, yeah, she taught us to read, and she helped us do our 4-H projects. But
they don't remember that as much. You know, it's those little moments like that that they'll recall over and over and over again. Like when you made a fort and you did all these things. And I actually put sticky notes up around my house because I was raised, you know, in this very strict religious home where, you know, if you don't do stuff for God, then you have no worth.
Right.
And I had to write these sticky notes, TIW. I put them all over my house. This is worship. And God has joy when we have joy. And it changed my whole lens of this is what living for the Lord is about. It's about being in the moment. It's about being with the people he's put in front of me. It's not about looking religious or doing, you know, the checklist of things that I feel like I should do. And you do, you find your joy in that. And that's where you find God too.
Right.
So yes,
that's
such
so
a good lesson.
And, you know, I think I am not a good singer. I always wished I was a good singer, but I'm not a good singer. But singing hymns during your day or Broadway show tunes or whatever, to me, that lifts a whole element of joy. I think people that sing are happy people. And I know that when I watch my little 3-year-old grandchildren run around the house, half the time they're singing. And I just laugh because my one little 3-year-old grandson knows like some of the Fiddler on the Roof song, which I think is hilarious. And to me, that's just joy overflowing. And I really want to emphasize that as a family, if you can have joy overflowing, it won't matter what your kids learn. They will be happy, content people, and they will love life, and they will want to do things. They'll want to learn. They'll want to work. They'll want to serve others because they just have inner joy that spills out.
Yeah. Absolutely. And it should spill out. It shouldn't be forced. You really can't force joy anyways. I know. And mine comes through movement. I lead a workout in worship. And actually, I'm excited because when I'm speaking in Iowa, they're having me do it as a session. If you're going to be in Iowa, not this coming weekend, but next weekend for the homeschool conference, I turn on my playlist, let it randomize, and I let the Holy Spirit like show me a specific move, and I just go for it. And so we build on that and do a workout with it. But it is the most amazing experience, even for me as a teacher. I do it with my eyes closed. I tell everybody, I don't care. You can look as crazy as you want, because I'm not watching it.
That's so awesome.
It's so good. I had to get beyond what other people were going to think about me. And I think that's what a lot of this diversity and prejudice and all these other things, you know, that you're really hitting on with your new book, hit is we can't be afraid to be who we are.
Right.
And then we also can't be afraid to accept people for the way that God made them. So, you know, living in a world that's like that, how do you live that way and stand confidently through the everyday and just against the culture?
Yeah, that's exactly right. You know, one of the things I talk about in my book is people's prejudgment of me or my family. And, you know, of course, I can't compare myself to people that have really had rough childhoods and have really had, you know, racial prejudice or socioeconomic, you know, prejudice. But right. I'll never forget the days when I had all my kids, which is a parade of diversity, at the grocery store, because I did take all of them. You know, that was an important thing to do. And of course, we had two grocery carts and spent way more money than we possibly could imagine. But we get to the checkout, and there was one of two different expressions by the cashier. One would be, "Oh, what a beautiful group of kids. Do you provide daycare?"
Yeah.
Okay. You know, and then the other expression was, "Wow, I could just never be around that many kids. How many kids do you have, and why aren't you stopping?" I just say, you know, it's just such a blessing. It is really crazy, but, you know, I just love them. You know, they're just so fun to be with. And then when we got out to the car, I'd be sure to tell my kids, you know, I just love you. Even if you acted up in the store, you're just so worth it to me. And people just say stupid things, and they say hurtful things. And, you know, because we have the confidence in the Lord, we know what we're supposed to be doing, and we just do it. And, you know, in a world that hates families, hates marriage, hates kids, we're just going to hear it. And so you just expect it, and you teach your kids that they'll, you know, they're going to hear it, they expect it, but it's not the way it's supposed to be. And how are we going to grow up and make it different for other people? And I love where I live right now. I live in Southwest Florida, Peggy knows. And it's a very multicultural area. I just love it. You know, I have all these medical providers right now. And, you know, they're from India, or they're from Cuba, or, mm-hmm. you know, who, wherever. And it's just so fun to talk to them and find out about their background and how hard it was to get to where they are now. And yeah. to just say, gosh, I just am so glad you're here. You know, mm-hmm. they're excellent doctors and I'm so grateful to have them. And I'm glad that my parents taught me to be open-minded. And, you know, just because you disagree with people on ideology or religion or politics is not equal hate. That's the big thing right now is, oh, yeah. well, if you don't believe in this, then you must hate me. It's like, no, I don't hate you. And of course, there's, you know, a lot of people are living immoral lifestyles, but that doesn't mean I hate them. It just right. means that I hope that they'll come to know Jesus so they know how to live by the Ten Commandments and by Jesus's, you know, what he taught about mm-hmm. to love thy neighbor as thyself and to follow God's commandments. Because mm-hmm. that's where we find our confidence and our joy.
Right, exactly. And you want people to feel, you know, it's not that you want to change people. You want them to be who God created them to be in the first place. Exactly. You know, it's like I'm not opposed to you, but yes. I really think there's stuff that you're missing and I don't want you to miss out. And that's when you exactly see it from right. that perspective, then you're like, that is out of love.
Yeah.
Because exactly. there is so much more that you just have no grasp of yet. Because yeah. haven't released into what God created you to be. Instead, we, you know, we try to be who we think other people think we should be, or who, who we think we should be. So, right. yeah, right. a lot of that. Yeah.
I was just going to say, one of the things that I always doubted myself about was I was always kind of a chubby kid. And I did sports, but still I was chubby. And when I got married, of course, then I got pregnant and gained weight, never lost it and all that. I was expressing something to my husband who said, you know what? We made all those babies. I made you exactly the way you look. It's okay. You look like one of those Renaissance painting women. I'm like, okay, that's all I needed to hear.
What a lovely husband. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, okay, so we have some yeah. questions, I think.
Yes, we had some questions sent in from viewers ahead of the show. And if you do not know about that, we have a link that we always provide on the YouTube video and on our empoweredhomeschool.com.org website that you can submit your questions ahead of time. Or if you're on our newsletter email list, we'll send that out to you the night before. So Linda had a question about, can multiple levels of learning be done together? That's one that a lot of parents have, especially with big families like yours. So you're a good person to answer this question.
Yes, this is such a great question. So I think people get in the box of institutional school and they think, okay, this is what a first grader does. This is what a fifth grader does.
Right. And that
has some merit, you know, some of it's based on child development and that's okay. But when we had, five kids in homeschooling every two grade levels, and it was totally
right.
off, what the system that worked for us is that each morning I would help individually each child do math and English. We would sit at the kitchen table. The kids would rotate out like every 15 minutes. And the mm-hmm. other kids would be busy with chores like cleaning their room or watching the little toddler or doing their piano practice, you know, something right. constructive. And then mm-hmm. we rotate out to the next person. And some of the kids were very resistant learners. Some of them were, just get right through it. And but still, like through high school, I would help my kids with their English and math individually. Right. So we'd get that done. And then they had some other schoolwork they could do on their own. And for the little mm-hmm. kids, it was like coloring pages and things like that.
Right.
But then we would regroup and have lunch. And then we'd go mm-hmm. outside, play baseball, and I'd hit the home run.
every day.
Yeah. And then we would have a block class that we rotated. So like Monday, it could be history. Tuesday, it could be science. Wednesday, it could be our errands to town and piano lessons. Thursday, it could be something. And then Friday, often we would have art. And we did that as a group, and we would do it so that the older kids, their intellectual needs were met, and the younger kids could just listen and participate at their level. A lot of times we would do a hands-on activity. Because of my art background and my husband being an architect, when we studied history, we would study and build like models of castles or pyramids out of sugar cubes. You know, we'd always have some kind of fun thing. And then if I had like an infant or a toddler, they would be taking their nap during that time. And so the younger kids saw what the older kids were doing, and it really helped them a lot be interested in things. And I was just amazed at what they would hear. A lot of times I would just read right out of the textbook, have the older kids answer questions, and the younger kids would like participate. It was amazing. And then the older kids, I might say, okay, that's, we're done with our group lesson. Now go answer the questions on piece of paper in your notebook or whatever. And so we would extend the learning for the kids who were at a higher grade level. But yes, I absolutely think that learning as a group, multi-age, is a great way to go. One of the things that I have done in the past is I've helped to write curriculum for thegenerations.org. And I wrote their elementary science and history workbooks that go with the text. And it has all these fun hands-on things that we did. Like we did a whole Viking unit and we, you know, went and picked grapes and dyed fabric purple and we built little boats and sailed them in the bathtub. And I think that that kind of thing is really good for older kids, but also for younger kids. They can participate. The learning sticks, no matter what kind of learner you are. When you do stuff with your hands, I think it sticks. And so I would
and that
say
was that, kind of a question too with one of our other viewers was asking a similar question, and I want to make sure to get that one in too. But she had said, where can I get help building the right curriculum for my five neurodiverse medically complex trauma kids with great vocabularies and hyperlexia, but learning differences and difficulties, especially with writing, and more specifically with getting what's in their head through their hands on the paper. So you would you recommend then the more hands-on type of things there as well?
I would. I first of all, it's great that they have a high vocabulary and they're good readers, because I think that's key to a lot of future learning. And I think a lot of kids have what's maybe called pencil resistance. They don't know what to write. They don't, they can't write. They don't want to write. They hate to write. I know I was kind of a kid, but now I'm a writer for my life. So I think, first of all, you have to have something to write about. So one of the things I did with my younger kids, well, and my older kids too, is I had them write letters. I had them write cards to their relatives, letters maybe to neighbors, different people, because then they could talk about their life. I think you have to give your kids something they know about to then write about. And a, fun game that we played was a story game where I said, okay, I'm going to start with a sentence and then you add the next sentence. So we did that verbally for a long time, for years. But then when they got to be middle school, we'd say, okay, now I want you to write one a one paragraph story, and I'm going to start with the first sentence. And so then I'd write the sentence out, and then they could say whatever they wanted to. So I think that you have to give kids confidence in their penmanship. So you got to work on that a little bit, whether it's printing. And I do advise cursive writing. I think that's really important to learn cursive after you've mastered, you know, just print. before you get on the computer. I think you need to learn those. But then you just start writing, and it could be about anything. It could be ridiculous writing, could be made up story, right, or whatever. Mm-hmm. What do they love? So if you have a fifth grade boy who loves cars, but he hates writing. So what does he want to write about? Well, draw a picture of your favorite car. Okay. Then write the name of the car and who drives it. Okay, so it's a red Corvette, and it's driven by Mr. So-and-so, who's actually, you know, he's an advertising manager, or he's a spy, or he's a Spider-Man, or whoever. So they're writing about what they love. Keep it short and to the point. Don't correct it. Do not correct your writing.
Yeah.
Let them just pour it out. Then when they get older and they're starting to write paragraphs, you know, you can help them learn, okay, there's an opening sentence, there's a closing sentence, and then there's three paragraphs. So the opening paragraph, the middle supportive, and the closing paragraph. But it's a step-by-step process. And what is the goal of learning to write? Well, the goal of learning to write is when you're an adult, you can write a letter, you can write a job application, you can, you know, write a report. And that doesn't have to happen by fifth grade or seventh grade. And so maybe by 12th grade, they can do that. And what I think is my kids who hated writing in elementary school got a little bit interested in it in middle school. But then by high school, they had things they wanted to write about. And our kids were 4-H, which is a wonderful extracurricular activity. And they wanted to write long reports all about what they did on their project. And then two of my kids in 11th grade, they said, for English this year, can we write a novel? I'm like, well, sure. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And so they did. And so they got it all out, you know, their rough draft. And I said, okay, now we're going to go back and I'm going to show you some corrections. And we did all of this, you know, using an actual pencil and paper.
Wow.
And then they would learn to start correcting their own writing. And even though they weren't good spellers, weren't good editors, eventually, guess what? Now they're in their 30s and they're fantastic.
Wow.
So it doesn't happen at the structure that everybody says it has to happen at.
Right.
And
exactly.
So you may have a student who does great and they can learn, you know, they can do IEW program or something like that in middle school or high school. But you might have a highly gifted student who can read the encyclopedias, but can't really write down what they know. And that's okay. Just help them step by step, one at a time, slowly and surely. And by 12th grade, hopefully they can at least write a job resume. They can write an inquiry letter, because it's a process and it does not happen at a set year like everybody wants to think it does. It happens when people are ready and when they have the ability to do it.
Yeah. So Rainey, who had put in the question before, she's watching live and she said these kids have connective tissue disorders and can't write anything at length. Plus they have dysgraphia. So we have connective tissue disorders at our house. I have EDS and we've just recently found out that was underlying my issue and all my kids' issues. So we did a lot of those verbal stories as well. Hiking, somebody would name out three things and they'd have to make up a story with it, you know, and then they'd throw in all these other crazy things. But a lot of the verbal, the audio, you know, and it was amazing just how even when my oldest son couldn't read, he was listening to audiobooks, and in a year he was at the college level. So yes, we have zebras too. So that's what they call kids with people with EDS are zebras, because there's 15 different forms of EDS. So we're in the same boat. but yeah, I love that, Sherry, that, you know, you just have to, eventually they will get up to that. And I have to encourage you, Rainey, too, that a lot of it is what we found with our family is a lot of muscle work, because now one of the reasons I do aerial is in my 50s, it's the only way my joints stay together. and so I can't sit down for very long. I'm always up and moving because that disorder causes me to be in a lot of pain, and my daughter too. So yeah, we just have to constantly be moving.
So. You know, one of the things that we didn't really talk about that I think is super important is our kids' diet. And when kids have food sensitivities or they have allergies, all that affects their learning, their behavior. And, you know, especially when you have more than one kid and not necessarily genetically related to you, you have to be a private detective. And
oh, absolutely.
The more your diet can be, the less junk food, the less processed food. And we always had a water and healthy snack break mid-morning and mid-afternoon, so that the kids' brain stayed activated and we had good, healthy fat. You know, we have this weird thing where like, no fat, but your brain needs fat.
Yes, the brain needs fat. Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
And so I think that's a really important thing. And we were sort of foodies because we lived on a farm. We raised our own food. We loved to cook, we loved to eat. And my one daughter became a professional chef. But I think that diet is super important, and having your kids eat a good breakfast before they start their schoolwork, and then have a snack and have a good lunch, and they can participate making all that, so it's not all on you. But I do think
teaches them good skills, definitely, that way.
I think any kid that has issues, so to speak, you've got to really take a look at what they're putting in their mouth.
Absolutely. So many things. Well, Sherry's book, we got to let them know about that. It's Embracing Diversity as a Family, Preparing the Next Generation to Flourish. It will be available on Amazon soon, but it is listed on Amazon, and I've got the link there. I'll put it in the show notes too, so that you can find it more easily. But and then on your website, can people find the book there as well?
They will at some point. It's
at some point.
Wait for the Amazon link. But you can email me and any questions. And I am happy to give free phone consultation to people that just really want to talk. I'm just happy to do that. I'm available. This is what I love to do, is encourage parents. And your kids are absolutely worth all the time, all the stress, all the money. They will grow up. This too shall pass. And you know, we're parents for life, and it's way worth it if we just seek the Lord about what to do.
Absolutely. And Sherry's website, if you're listening to the podcast, is sherrymcminn.com, and I will also put that link in the show notes, so you can click on that as well to find the rest of her resources and all your other books too. Sherry's got lots of resources and about totally different topics too. You just write about a range of things. So so yes, if you're looking for some really good summer reading, check out Sherry's website at sherrymcminn.com. So Sherry, this was amazing. It was such a good conversation. We could probably talk for hours. But I appreciate you taking time out, and let's see. We had one more comment. Rainey, she said thank you. Yeah, you're welcome. And we're just happy to be here to help. And I know that's Sherry's heart too, as you just heard. So reach out to her on her website if you have questions for her. And she'll definitely get you connected and answer those questions. So thanks so much, Sherry. I appreciate you greatly, and for all the work that you do in Colorado, and all the work you do to help us here at Sped Homeschool as well. So
you bet, it's my pleasure.
Yeah, and if you don't know, we actually have a brand new website as of Saturday afternoon. It was supposed to, Angie said, Sherry, she's going to be reaching out to you. So we have a brand new website. And it just went live. It was supposed to go live somewhere on Friday night, but there was some DNS transfer issues. So it went up now, but this is our new website. It's called Homeschool Heroes. And on there, you can build an account and connect with other homeschool families. You can share stories. There'll be events on there. There's groups and resources, but just so much more than our other website used to have. And we have admins on there. And so if you want to start connecting with other families, you can actually build your own local group and say where you're located and other people can find you. And you can do that for free. So I just encourage you, if you were on our email list, you got a code to get into the Navigator level, which is the first paid tier up for free for 3 months. And if you missed that and you really want to get that code, email us at office@spedhomeschool.com and we will send that to you. But we want you to hop on, try it out, and connect. Because like Sherry, like you said, we need community. We are created for community. And that's why I'm so excited about having this website and having that ability for people to just be able to connect, to share their stories and to get the support that they need. Because that's really what we need more so than any resource that's out there. We have lots of resources, but it's the encouragement and the connections that get us through. So
exactly. Yeah. And if I can awesome. Just give one plug to the Rocky Mountain mm-hmm. Homeschool Conference, we're having a unique leaders workshop seminar day and lots of tracks. And we're actually having a community meetup, which should be so fun. And I think almost 200 people have registered. So we're really excited about that. Awesome. If you're in the Colorado area and want to come to the Rocky Mountain Homeschool Conference.com next week, I'd love to meet you in person.
Yes. Yeah. And I'll be in Virginia. I'm leaving tomorrow. I'll be keynoting the HEAV Special Needs Conference on Thursday. So I'll be doing that. And looks like there's a lot of registrants for that as well. So lots of things going on. And the Special Needs Homeschooling Expo is coming up in Shelby, North Carolina as well. And me and a couple of my co-hosts for the show will be there as well. So lots of things going on this summer to get you connected and to get you support. So definitely tap into those things. Next week, I will not be on the show. We'll have a pre-recording though. One of my co-hosts, Annie Yorty, will be recording a session with a couple that just wrote a book, but they're going to be talking about thriving together, strengthening your marriage while raising children with disabilities. So that is coming up next week. And then the week after, I'll be back live. So we'll have another topic for you to dive into. I'm just continuing to encourage you and share resources, but make sure to check out Sherry's new book when it comes out. Watch for that. And we will keep the links in the show notes so that you can find those right away. But thank you, Sherry, again. Appreciate you and love all that you're doing and all the support that you provide. And just keep up the good work and take care of yourself. I know you're getting better. You look amazing. So can't wait to see you in person again soon.
Sounds great. I'll look forward to it. I'm hoping to be in Houston in October, so we'll look forward to that.
Awesome. Yes. All right. Well, thanks everybody for joining us. We'll see you next time here on Empowering Homeschool Conversations. Take care and God bless. Bye.
Thank
everyone.
You. Bye-bye.
Yep. I want to take just a second to thank the team at Life Audio for their partnership with us on this podcast. If you go to lifeaudio.com, you'll find dozens of other faith-centered podcasts in their network. They've got shows about prayer, Bible study, parenting, and more.
This has been Empowering Homeschool Conversations.
This is Chris Christensen, and back in 2006, I started a simple project. A project to try and introduce more people to the Bible through Bible study called the Bible Study Podcast. It's a simple name and a simple idea. Each week, every week, we study one chapter of the Bible, talk about what it says, and what that might mean for us today. To listen now, go to lifeaudio.com or search for the Bible Study Podcast on your favorite podcast app.